page concerning the facilities and slots. Chair has joined us and given the status update on these projects.
Good morning. So you have before you on page two, the list of our facilities for slots eight. We put these in a recommended order, but it's all subject to change and based upon direction. We have the amounts there and then we'll go through each one. If you have any questions, just let me know. The first one is the soccer complex at Thorpe Lounge, phase two. So in phase one, yes, sir.
I'm sorry, I'm looking at my other.
That's the.
I have the slots eight facilities have.
One more, sir. So phase one, to get the project and budget that we've currently finished with standard contract, we've several items were removed or vacated here from the project. So the first phase two, the first project we had was to go ahead and add those items back in, which includes lighting all eight fields, building the maintenance building, paving the parking area, playground equipment, and field amenities. If you'll see the picture there below, that is as it is today. That's the picture that we had that drone footage taken of. That project looks good. The grass isn't fully covered the fields in time of what we're doing, but it will not take long. By the time we add in the phase two items, everything will be ready to go. And that is a total of $3.7 million is what we have budgeted for that.
Y'all recall, you can let on that page, but it gives a list of those items that included in this phase one.
Yep. The next one is the sheriff's office. We, it was a slot recommend we ask to install some new roofs. Pod A, Pod B, and over the administration area. We've already moved forward with Pod A and Pod B. There was some HVAC equipment installed on those pods, so we need to go ahead and move forward with getting the roof work done so we can get the curb work around the units completed, and that project is actually ongoing. We'll speak. And then right after that's done, we'll move forward with the administration area. The Carnegie Library, which is the historic museum, that project includes a new roof, ceiling the north side of the basement, and making repairs to the board panels in the ceiling and basement area. They called us a few years ago to go over there and look, and staff found everything was going on with it, which is the reason for the request. The animal shelter. So in SPOS 7, of course, we asked for $800,000, which was passed. And once we got into it, we realized that we really needed a new shelter. And everything was approved. We got the $3 million plus the $800,000. Programming is almost totally complete. We got it to a point and we got to make sure the spot eight passed. Now we're going to move forward with finishing that up and starting the construction document.
The timeline on that?
We can have, if you look back to page two, right now we have it going ahead and starting design, and at the end of this year or the first of 2021, bidding that. I expect it takes about 6 to 8 months to finish the design and construction documents based on previous meetings.
While you're looking at page two, you'll note that there are we would utilize the same selection procedure we did previously, and that is a rotation basis of our locals, unless there is a project such as the courthouse, if you recall, we did a bid process, but we didn't have so much interest and experience. But in these projects, unless you give us other direction, we would recommend that we continue that process of rotation selection. Is there any objection? What was the rotation?
I don't have a list with me, but of course there's Ben Gregory, McCall is on here, Gladwin Pond is on here, Ellison Rickett, Altman Barrett, Jimmy Sean.
Ted, have you ever had any problems with doing this work? I mean, have you ever had any squabble about, well, he got a $600,000 project and I got a $300,000 project?
Pretty much they've all been pretty happy to the fact they're getting the work and not having to go through the process of an RFP every project and fighting without town firms. So far, I have not heard anything. Most of you guys have, but I have not.
We see her at ACG everywhere else.
That's right.
She's involved in it.
They were.
And then rotation.
Once we get on that, they actually just completed the project for us for 911, and we would continue that relationship in 911. And to answer your question, Scotty, we try to look at the numbers. And some may get two projects based on, okay, you only have 300,000 here, okay, you might get another one here that's 800,000. And we also look at the history of one way of doing an $18 million project.
Chad, I totally trust your judgment on that. If you think it's fair and it's working, I say we don't mess with it.
Do you think it's a set percentage?
Yes, sir. 8%.
Yeah, they're all the same.
That's why you really can't bid it out, you know, because nobody's going to trade it. They're always the same price.
And I guess what I'm thinking, what if you name by six companies.
That's right.
And so if you're, let's say, you're number six and you're number one, you got a while before you can get another project.
That's a possibility. One other thing, Mr. Prisman, I talked about is going ahead and getting all these projects in a design phase. In the past, we have actually waited a little longer, depending on where that project lived on bid date, and then we didn't start the design process until then.
If you'll note the dates here, they're all 2020, with that all in mind, that you try to get these out, and they were good.
When money became available, our project wasn't moving along as fast as we thought it would. We could have one ready, we could go forward with it. Or if we saw any issues, just say like the animal shelter. It was lower on the list and SPLOST 7, so we waited a little longer to hire the architect. Well, we might have caught what we'd seen a lot sooner if we knew sooner, and we could plan better. This is a thought process there. And if we complete the design construction documents, and we have to wait a little while, that's fine. We'll have good budget numbers, we'll have good documents, and everything's ready to go when it comes available.
Have you ever had anyone be willing or submit a bid for less? I guess we haven't did this, but anyone willing to do it for less than 8% of the project?
If you went through a bid process at different times, depending on where somebody is in the work process, you could see a top of percentage. Based on history, when we've done that, they were all in that 8% range. And what we've done with previously for SPLOST 7 is, let's keep it local here with these guys at 8%, and that way they get their fair share of what is local.
I haven't, and I talk a lot with the architects, and I haven't heard any objection whatsoever to the way CAD does it. It's fair to them, it normally works for them. If you went through an actual bid process, you might be able to save a little bit, but you also could get into a situation where one architect is getting all of it, as much as any, I mean, it could happen. So this gives us a little bit of flexibility to be able to work with all of them and spread it around. It just means that it has, there's a process, everybody can't be working on the same problem, of course, so. It just straight, I haven't heard of that.
They have all been pretty grateful when we met with them, talked with them about the process, especially when they're getting the project, but, the process works, good to give it a little cheaper, a good process is, depending on their workloads, like right now, that could go up based on a bid process.
I think you produce a better product doing it this way too, because there are certain architects who are better at certain things, you know? So, you know, he has the flexibility to say, well, how about you do this one in firm A, and you do this one, and you're a better fit for, you know what I'm saying?
What if someone wants to get in the circle, someone new, saying that has a good value from another city or state, and they moved to Hines County, they want to get in the rotation, what would they do?
They would contact, typically start either with a commissioner, or they contact county manager's office, and then they end up with their staff. Case of one, level of bonds, that same thing happened with them. Of course, their process was a RFP process, but when they moved to town as BFB Gladwin, they did, they came and marketed their company, and that's how the process started. If anybody new moves to town, that's part of the marketing process. They'll go around to all cities, counties, private individuals to market their company, and that's when we start looking at as well.
Do we have to put anything on the state website? One time we were saying we had to put some stuff on the state.
Where's the list?
If we were soliciting, we would be receiving bids from any qualified firm, and we would evaluate those qualifications, Chad. But we would not eliminate anybody from submitting a bid to us, and yes, we would have to advertise that as a legal requirement.
Yes, I guess this one, was it the state requirement that came down that we must
have right.
Some things?
If we put a project out for bid that doesn't include professional services, we have to put it on the state credit registry. That's all of our projects. That is the requirement that came down last year.
Okay.
Any more questions on that, Michelle?
Okay.
The next project was the health department, which is the REC acquisition. This is the building, the Southern Regional Commission building, right behind the health department administration building that the county owns. And what we'd like to do is purchase this building. This will expand our footprint on Savannah Avenue. Future when we decide to expand or build new on that footprint, we'll have a big enough footprint to do that. And they are in the actual process of building their new building by the Hines County Board of Education. That's the Flyville Community Center. This includes construction of a new community center that will match the one the Flyville Park. We would obviously go back to Glenn Gregory on this one with the same concept here.
This is a project that both Mark
Bean Grove Fire Department on the south end of the building with EMS bay and living quarters. And then our parking lot would actually be removed from where it is and just moved to the south along with the expansion. We've already been meeting Jimmy Combs on that building, and we've already been meeting with him to make sure it was doable before we put it on the SPOS 8. So we'll be moving forward with those soon as well. Getting those construction documents ready. South side library on Griffin Avenue includes expanding the building out the south end gable or the east end gable. It can be done on either gable. And this will allow for the children's area and expanding the parking lot as far as we can to gain clean parking spaces as needed for that too.
Question on this?
Staff met with the library with Miguel about 2 weeks ago and went over the project with them, answered any questions they had. This project includes interior renovation. We've done the previous project for SPOS 7, there were 4 offices, administration offices that weren't able to be renovated. So that includes renovating those 4 offices, a new roof, and a metal storage building. Phase one, we had to remove their existing storage building to expand for the operations area. So we installed a new metal storage building. Senior Citizens Center, this includes construction at a location to be determined. The center, the way we have the price is planned to be the same size as the existing one on Park Avenue, which was around a little over 16,000 square feet. And like I say, that project, we'll get to work on that, meeting with the OPRA and staff to determine the location and moving forward.
And for clarification, this is not in place of, this is in addition to.
Record storage. Record storage building is a building that will get the county started with clean and easy access for record storage. We're working on location at this time for the best place for this. We had a facility in the previous SPOS, and for the Sheriff's Department, they were able to utilize and renovate an existing area in the jail to use for their record storage.
As y'all are aware, there are records stored currently in the historical courthouse. And y'all going through that. And when we first moved into the admin building, those records cataloged and stored over there. And it is going to be necessary to remove those documents to a secure location that is also climate controlled. And while the sheriff's determination of utilizing existing space is workable for his office, it's necessary, I think, that we construct this storage space for all of the offices of the county where our records are stored or need to be stored. And the way Chad and I have discussed this will be basically a red steel building designed with separation walls for security access by the various department or office, suppression system for fire control, and for heating air to control of those documents. We think we'll have an easy access
most, so it's going to be closer.
But for the reason for the sheriff's office, probably security.
With this, and this is kind of getting way out of the moment, could this potentially involve staffing from the standpoint of an actual catalog record keeper there on premises? To file into?
Previously, we have had, we utilize private storage whereby an office would say, I need these documents. Those documents were collected and brought to you. And you paid for the storage, you paid for the collection, you paid for the retainage of that space, you paid to return it.
I did $10.
So it was better than what we obviously had. Can it grow into that? I think it's realistic to the commission to assume that in the future, that would be a reasonable request from some of those officers that you want to exist.
Yeah, but we initially, back in on Squad 7, we initially identified it as records and evidence, especially for the sheriff's department. And really, it does make sense that the sheriff would be the gatekeeper for that evidence. I know at some points, of course, but he's the one who holds that evidence. He's responsible for it. And there, from the standpoint of the documents, the records, those sorts of things, then that falls back on us. And certainly, I could see where it involved staffing just from the standpoint of being able to retrieve those records on a timely fashion, rather than anybody and everybody going out there and going into the space and going and trying to find a firebox.
So
it's cataloged and kept, and it's easy to find.
Related to that, it's just as important is local governments in Georgia have to follow the retention schedules for those records that are established by the Secretary of State office, and they usually update that schedule every 2 years. So it's just important, to your point, to make sure we're not keeping things longer than we should. I think the sheriff did a really good job in going in and cleaning up that evidence. And I know Mr. Pritchard has been on us simply because we were paying for storage for so long to make sure that we were not keeping things longer than we were supposed to. So there should be marked as they go into storage or
someone to catalog it and keep it.
Because I was wondering, similar to what you said, just how big the place check is big on capacity.
Oh, I think we're to build it for, as Jared said, long-term plan, but it will be certainly built initially more than this for those records in the courthouse. And we have some records third floor that we would be able to move. Stephanie has some, we have some. So the plan would be to build the facility, and it would be designed in such a way we could add on to that.
For your expansion?
Yeah.
To answer your question right now, we're going to build a building. It's going to cost $375,000. Whatever that gets us.
This will get us started.
Get us started.
And then.
Well, the good thing is a lot of the data and stuff is digitized. I mean, nowadays, you still got the paper and all. A lot of stuff is going digital. It reminds me, even CD runs, you don't need to see those anymore.
As we get into our next project on the list, Mr. Pritchard stated earlier, if you haven't been in the courthouse, there is a lot clerk or storage in there that she has to keep the hard copies. Staff actually went in and built special shelving for that, those documents. And that's one of the main reasons for this building, is we got to have somewhere for that to go for the construction.
That's the immediate thing.
To give you an idea, the shore up the flooring in the courthouse, we got to be able to carry that weight in the rooms.
In addition, she also has stuff in the private storage facility as well. So we're paying for storage for a lot of documents for the clerk's office, in addition to what's in the courthouse.
But back to what Mr. Marshall was saying, also, is there an opportunity to digitize a lot of those documents to, as you begin to move forward, scanning them through electronically so that you got them that you don't necessarily have to have?
And those are responsibilities of those constitutional officers. They come to us and say, this is what we're required to do. We need X, Y, or Z. We need this. So, yes, but we don't go in and tell them how, what they need.
Ms. Fisher, I keep budget up on the other end.
Sure.
It would be hundreds of thousands of dollars to store all of that in the, in a way, to restrict it.
Yes, sir. So our next project is the courthouse renovation, which is on SWAT State, was a $9 million request, and on SWAT 7, we have $2 million for a total of 11. Of course, in the last year, the committee selected Gladwin Bond. Since that time, a full existing conditions assessment has been done of the building. A full environmental assessment has been done. And a 3D survey. They have started the design document for the basement area. And as of last week, we've started doing a selective demo. So the architect can gain access to certain ceiling areas, certain wall, inside the wall areas, to determine the exact structure of certain areas. And so the structural engineer can get in and the electrical. We suspect this to take the rest of this month doing the selective demo processes. Then she's able to move forward with complete design phase. Actually, I have a set of plans here, the selective demo plans, as well as the existing conditions and the basement layout. It's moving along very well so far, and there's been a lot learned about that building in the last year.
Do you have any sketches or anything what possibly would look like inside? I know we talked about different possibilities.
So
shops and tourism stops and everything like that.
So what we have currently is on the first, second, and third floors, all existing layouts. She also has, her direction at this time is full restoration. So what she's doing right now is going back to the original layouts, the original walls. She has that information. And of course, the selective demo will take this even further. What we do have is a proposed layout for the basement at this time. That's the biggest change as far as at this time, as far as walls, as far as layouts, which will allow for more bathrooms and a more space set. Right now, it wasn't utilized very well. But as far as what the proposed layout is going to be, no, that's not fully complete yet. As far as the lobby goes in the second and third floor.
There's some of those walls down there that were added over the years that Chad and I had discussed. Chad had discussed with Selena to eliminate those. So I think she's got some kind of maybe a rough sketch on how that would look with the removal of those walls and some of them not loaded. So it's really going to be, that is going to be kind of a simple part as far as mechanical and so forth, and how do we utilize that and upgrade and modernize that building. Certainly
the courthouse, what we're going to use it for, and possibly have to give them direction.
I think that you, that is preliminary at this point, because while you all have discussed ideas and potential uses, I don't think anything has been determined. So there will, once we start this, we do this preliminary analysis, I think then she will be coming back to the board and saying, okay, this is what I think. Where do you want us to go with usage? Now, the usage so far has been very, very general. It's just been office-related, trying to remain as close to the historical design as possible, but to modernize that to the level that we can in order to make it serviceable and useful to the public. Is that?
Well, I think that's exactly it. I think you've got to get to the point. Of course, the direction was to bring the building back to its historical original construction, and there's a lot of stuff that's been done over the years. So you've got to get all that demoed out, and then that gives us time, but along the line of what Mr. Griffin was saying, certainly those are some discussions and some decisions that we're going to have to make. Once we get into it, there may be some issues as some of this collective demo is done that says, well, this is the only way this area can be utilized based on construction, additional support, whatever might happen. And so I don't think we're quite there yet, but probably this year, next year, or something.
I think it's fair to say that last quarter of this year, the very first of next year, the board will have to reach decisions, because she will need that time to stay on the way. At this point, she's able to work within the confines of what I described and what she had given me.
Because the one thing that we did say, that we kind of, everybody has a consensus, everybody that believes in the courthouse, I mean the courtroom being upgraded or being there, the whole courtroom itself.
Yeah, that's probably changed.
But everything else is also more stuff.
There's been discussion, but it's been very minimal. When you start going back to the historical construction, you reference in that courtroom, that you're referencing the recreation of the balcony that was there. So when you do that, you eliminate some possible usage area that has been turned into offices. So it's going to come down for the board to decide, and can I architecturally do this, and if so, at what cost? Do we need to do that? Is it such that you need that floor space for utilization, or you don't, and you say, well, yeah, we want to restore that because of the historical nature? That will have to be determined.
And yes, I do have some sketches here, drawings, you know, that we will look at, as well as the existing conditional assessments and our selective demo procedures that we're currently in. The last sheet you have there, it's a series of projects with VLPRA. That will happen throughout.